I'm a basic girl. And as a basic girly, I just read what they tell me to read. Hello, I'm Nichelle, and today I'm going to be talking about the top 10 books I read in 2021. I thought about doing a video where I went through every single book I read in 2021, but I read 150 books, and that seemed like too many to go through. I was like, that's going to take 27 years, and is it going to be boring? Like, very likely yes. And so we're just going to go through the highlights. And since this is my first video, I'm also going to be talking about what these books would tell you about me, so you can learn a little bit more about me. If you want all 150 books I read last year, I did make a blog post that lists and ranks all of them. So you can go from my worst to best, maybe my best to worst. I haven't actually finished it yet, so you and I will know at the same time. Well, not the same time, but both of us don't know yet what order it's ranked. So I'm going to warn you that not a single one of these books did come out in 2021. These are just books that I read in 2021. They're also the most basic choices. I wouldn't be surprised if you know every single one of these books. Maybe you've read every single one of these books, but I'm a basic girl, and as a basic girly, I just read what they tell me to read. So you've heard of them. Number 10 is The Invisible Life of Addie, LaRue by V.E. Schwab. The Invisible Life of Addie, LaRue, if you haven't heard of it, is this book that follows this girl, Addie, LaRue, as she lives through her life, which is very, very long, because towards the beginning of the book, she makes a deal with, he's not the devil. Sometimes I hear people call him the devil. He's not the devil, he's just like, you know, a tricky trickster. She makes a deal with him, and the deal is she's gonna get to live forever, but no one will remember her. She, like, leaves the line of sight of people, they forget that she was there. Or, if she's with them all night, as soon as, like, morning comes or they fall asleep, they forget her. So she's in, like, a tricky spot. And we kind of just, like, follow her life from, she's born in, like, 17th century France, I think, all the way to the modern day and all of her shenanigans with this, like, tricky trickster god that created this situation. And then also when this boy named Henry finally remembers her. My favorite part of this book is how it is written and how V.E. Schwab talks about Addie's just, like, love of life. Because Addie, at her core, just finds so much joy and love in her life, this, like, crazy life that she's living where no one remembers her, but she's out here, like, making the most of it. And my least favorite part is the romance in this book. So Henry, the boy that she, like, has a thing with, they, like, have a romance because, honestly, it's a romance of convenience. She is forgotten by everyone except Henry. Henry's the only one who remembers her, so, like, obviously they're gonna have a romance. I do think it was one of convenience. I don't think they were that compatible. It was, like, the most boring romance ever. But, like, did I care? No, because the rest of the book was so brilliantly good. What does this book say about me? I've heard, like, really mixed things on this book. Some people, like, love it, love, love it. Some people think it's too slow. I've also heard that, like, it's, like, a little bit too trite. I think this book is for the Mary Oliver girlies. And I would consider myself a Mary Oliver girly. This is for the girls who, like, love poems, but they need them to be accessible. Like, I don't have enough up here. I took one English class in college, and it was called Women, Literature, and Murder. It was a good time, but I don't know how to read poems. Number 9, coming in hot, is With Lukov, From Love. So this year was really, or last year, 2021, was defined by me discovering both Booktok and Kindle Unlimited. I got Kindle Unlimited for like 6 months of last year, because I got it for free for like 3 months, and then they were like, if you pay like $5, you get it for 3 more months, and I was like, sign me the heck up. I don't have it currently, but I'm stockpiling all the books I'm going to want to read from Kindle Unlimited, and then I'll get it for a month or two and read through them. But I discovered Mariana, Zapata towards the end of my Kindle Unlimited time, and this is my favorite of the Mariana, Zapata books, but honestly, I loved most of them. If you haven't heard of Mariana Zapata, she's like a special little brand of romance books. She writes these like chunkers. They're like 500 pages long. And they're like slow burn. Like, these guys are not kissing until like the 90% mark, and they are so good. When I heard about them, the first one I heard about was The Wall of Winnipeg, and I was like, that looks disgusting. It looks like a football book. Also, slow burn sounds boring. No. It is everything I could have ever wanted. This one, From Lukov with Love, is an ice skating romance. So it's these two rival ice skaters have to be paired up. And then, you know, drama ensues. They fall in love. It's so good. And what does this say about me? This says that I love a romance book. Like, I love a romance book. According to StoryGraph, 70 of my 150 books were technically romance books. I don't totally buy that. Like, Assassin's Blade was a romance book, which, like, if you know Assassin's Blade by Sarah J. Maas, that book does not have a happy ending, which is, like, a pillar of the romance genre. So, romance-ish. But I do love a romance book. I'm not ashamed of it. Okay, number 8 was actually the last book I read in 2021, and it is A Sky Beyond the Storm by Sabra, Tahir, which is the final book in the Ember and the Ashes series, and oh my gosh, it was so good. My mom loves the series. This is her favorite book series, and so she finally convinced me to read it, and the first couple books were, like, fine. Like, they were good, but not, like, excellent, like, top tier, but I love a series that gets better, as we'll talk about. There's several series in here. And this book series, the final book, is so good. I love how we talked about the villain is, like, so morally ambiguous, and you, like, understand where he's coming from. And every single character is, like, morally ambiguous at some level. Like, no one is, like, 100% good and 100% bad. They, like, make mistakes. They also have, like, motivations that aren't 100% correct, and they're so, so, so good. And I loved, she kind of had, like, a more careful discussion about it in this book, about talking about, like, even the villains of the story are, like, someone that you can empathize with. And I think she does this better than maybe any other, certainly YA fantasy series I've ever seen. And then my least favorite part, this is, like, a little bit of a spoiler, so if you don't want to be spoiled, scoot ahead, like, 15 seconds. Could Helene have one nice thing? One. Helene really grew on me throughout the series. The first book I was like, annoying. Second book I was like, you're kind of annoying. Third book I was like, okay, maybe. Fourth book I was like, I love this girly. She's my ride or die. She's my favorite thing ever. And when, in the final battle, you know what happened. I was so mad. I was so mad. And then, you know, all of her stuff at the end, Elias and Laya are off having a great time, and she's stuck having the worst time ever. The worst time ever. I mean, probably not the worst time ever. She's had worse times, but, like, I just wanted her to have, like, one person, one nice thing, and she got nothing. Nada. So, justice for Helene. I told you, I'm a basic girl, and my number 7 pick is Song of Achilles. I did see it on Booktok. I read Circe by Madeline Miller when it came out, I think, like, 2018-ish. And I, like, enjoyed Circe, but not to the point where I was, like, reading went back. Because Song of Achilles, I think, came out before Circe. And I saw all of her book talk, and I finally bit the bullet and read it, and it was so good. Song of Achilles, if you aren't familiar, is the story of Achilles and Patroclus? I don't know how to say his name. I listened to the audiobook, and I still don't know how to say his name. But essentially, it's a retelling of their aspect of the Iliad, along with, I'm sure, other myths. Madeline Miller is a classicist, so she's, like, very familiar with Greek retellings, and this story is, like, so beautiful. I, like, knew the end because I'm, like, familiar with the Iliad, and I just, like, hoped that she changed the ending. And I, like, knew that it was sad, but you just, like, you hope despite it all that she's gonna change the ending for you, because you're just rooting for these guys so hard. And I, like, love how flawed they are, and you really get that sense of, like, the Greek tragedy and the, like, the fatal character flaw that leads them to their tragedy. And she does such a, like, beautiful job, and it was such a beautiful work. Number 6. Guys, my number 6 is the most basic on this list, probably. And it's A Court of Wings and Ruin. I could have chosen... Actually, I read A Court of Mist and Fury last year, and I didn't like it as much. I read the first two... This is the final book in the ACOWAR series. And I read the first two books in the ACOWAR series in 2020. And then I, like, was gonna stop. I, like, wasn't that enamored with them. Like, they were good, but they weren't, like, excellent. And I was gonna stop, but then I heard Silver Flames was coming out, and it was about Nesta, and Nesta's my favorite because I'm an oldest child, and so I love Nesta. So I was like, okay, I'll read the third one. And when I tell you, I was, like, ready to fight people. People bully Sarah J. Maas so much because they're like, oh, she can't write. And I think it's, like, a similar situation to, like, the Twilight situation. Am I saying this is a great literary work? Should this have won the Booker Man Prize? No. But is it total garbage? No, I think she did an excellent job, one, creating characters. Obviously, people are obsessed with this book. But I think also weaving, like, a plot that, like, comes together. I thought it was so good. I love the role of, like, Feyre's sisters and her family in this book. I think it's, like, so, so excellent. Is there parts where I am cringing? Yeah. Anytime she talks about people's bowels going watery, I do want to die just a little bit. But, it's okay. I did love this book. And then I read A Court of Silver Flames, and I also loved that book. She's good, okay? We're not done talking about her. Don't you even worry. And what does this tell you about me? I think this tells you how big of an impact Twilight had on my forming brain. The part of my brain that releases dopamine is shaped like those hands holding an apple. And I'm pretty, and like, for me, Reese is like very Edward Cullen shaped. Like, they have a lot of the same vibes. And so I think in my brain, the dopamine receptors really valued that. So this book gave me lots of dopamine. I also, like a sucker, and I did cry at the part, you know the part. If you've read it, you know the part. The part where he's, and even though I knew he came back, the fourth book is him. He's in it. So like, I knew, but I still cried because I'm a sucker. Anyway, number five, I love. This one is probably one of my more exotic, less basic options. And it is This Is How You Lose the Time War by Amal el-Mohtar and Max Gladstone. This book was so good. So good. The basic premise of the book is it's a sci-fi fantasy book, like sci-fi. We have these two women on opposite sides of a time war, like we have red and blue. And they're time travel agents, they're like going all through time, trying to like, I don't know. The big thing I want you to know about this is I didn't know what was happening in the plot. Okay, I've read this book twice now, and I still couldn't tell you, like, the plot, the, like, underlying structure, what's happening in the time war. I don't have one singular clue. I don't get it. But, and you're like, why did you pick this book then? Because these two women are exchanging love letters, and that story I did follow. The letters don't start off as love letters, but by the end of the book, they're in love with each other, and they are stunningly beautiful. I die. I die for them. I am, again, we're learning. I'm a sucker. I'm a hopeless romantic sucker. I love an emotional book. Loved these women falling in love with each other. Ugh, I could just like eat their letters with a spoon. Delicious. So good. And then on the other end of the spectrum, This Is How You Lose the Time War warms your heart. My next book actually just like truly destroyed me for months. Months. And that is A Little Life by Hanya, Yanagihara. This is commonly known as the saddest book of the internet. And, you know, that title is not without its merits. I did cry so hard at the end of this book that I thought I might throw up because I was, like, sobbing. And I did cry for a week whenever I thought of this book. And honestly, if I think about Jude St. Francis for too long, I will start to cry to this day. I read this book in May of last year. Hanya Yanagihara wrote, like, one of the most brilliant books I've ever read. I think the way in which she spun these characters and made you care about these characters and created just, like, these vivid portraits that, like, encapsulate your heart is stunning. I think her writing is beautiful. I hope to re-record a video soon about why I think A Little Life is such the saddest book of the internet, but why, essentially, it tugs at our heartstrings so effectively. I am concerned with the people who say this is their favorite book. This book is devastatingly sad, like nothing happy happens in it. That's not true, as I will go into in my longer video. Lots of happy stuff does happen, but it's like really bleak at the end. Like she talks about in this book how she wanted it to get from like lighter to darker. She wanted it to like ombre to hopeful to hopeless and bleak. And she does so effectively. It leaves you sobbing on the kitchen floor. We're ready for if you were feeling sad from A Little Life, I have a treat for y'all. It's Beach Read by Emily Henry. I, this year, read Beach Read in January, read it again in February, and read it again in June. I've read it three times. I love it. I've also read all of Emily Henry's collective works now. Beach Read is still my favorite. It is so good. If you're not familiar, because you live under a rock, it follows January and Augustus. They are both writers. January writes romance books, and Augustus writes, like, literary fiction. And January moves into this house that her father has left her, this beach house that he's left her after he's died, and it's the house he lived in with his mistress. And January has to, like, come to terms with that and, like, learn stuff about herself and, like, grieve her father's loss. And guess who lives next door? That's right, it's Gus. Gus Aroni. He lives right next door, and they were college rivals, but now they meet again, and they are, like, become friends, and then they fall in love, and it is so good. Emily Henry is a queen. So that's what we learned about this book, is I'm obsessed with Emily Henry. I think I read this book in, like, a pivotal developmental stage in my brain, maybe. I don't know. I'm old. So I don't think my brain is, like, really developing anymore. But I, like, imprinted on Emily Henry like a baby duckling, and I was like, I love this woman. We're best friends. I do call her M-Hen when I'm, like, speaking about her colloquially. So if you hear me talk about M-Hen, Emily Henry is who I'm talking about. Beach Read is my favorite of her books, but I've actually read all of them because Beach Read was so enamoring that I was like, gotta get them all. Okay, my next book is probably the book that I would say is objectively the best book I read this year, like, writing-wise. And it is In the Dream House by Carmen Maria Machado. And it is brilliant. It is so brilliant. It is a memoir of Carmen's time in an abusive relationship. But she tells this memoir in, like, these little vignettes that she structures, like, different literary devices. And they're not even literary devices. So you'll get a chapter that'll be, like, dream house as math problem, dream house as gothic horror, dream house as romance, dream house as, and she writes these chapters, and she, like, uses the tropes and, like, the structures of these little, some of them are genres, some of them are, like, specific devices, some of them are whatever. There's, like, a choose your own adventure story, and it is just, like, some of the most brilliant writing I've ever seen. And it tells such a poignant, beautiful story. I, like, felt privileged to have read it. Like, you can tell how much time she poured into this book and how much heart. And it just, like, truly was a privilege to be able to read it. So it was one of my favorite books of the year. My favorite book of the year is Queen of Shadow by Sarah J. Maas, which is the fifth book in the Throne of Glass series. I decided to pick up Throne of Glass pretty shortly after I finished A Court of Thorns and Roses because I was just so impressed with how Sarah J. Maas wrapped up the series. I really felt like she did a good job. Anyway, I think Throne of Glass is so fun. It's my favorite series of all time now. It replaced A Discovery of Witches, which used to be my favorite series. Also, still so good. But this one is now my favorite. If you're not familiar with the Throne of Glass series, it follows Selena Sarthothian. I don't know, her name's hard to pronounce, who is this assassin. And Throne of Glass starts with her being taken out of prison and being entered into this competition to become the king's champion. That's really not what the series is about, but I can't get into much more than that without, like, spoiling things. Queen of Shadow, we really are, like, we're no longer in that storyline at all, but we're hanging out with all of the cool girlies. The girls, the women in the series are just, like, top tier, so excellent. We're hanging out with, like, all of them. They're all being badasses and kicking butt. Manon is my favorite. It took me, like, such a long time to like Manon. In the first couple, we're introduced to Manon, I think, in the third book, and, like, the witches, and I'm like, why do I care? They, like, don't interact with any of the other people in the story for the entire third book. And I'm like, why are you telling me about these witches? I don't care. By the fifth book, Manon is my favorite character. And Abraxas, her, Wyvern, which I just pictured to look like Toothless from How to Train Your Dragon. Don't tell me I'm wrong. Anyway, Lysandra is also excellent. We've got Elid, we've got Nesrin. Like, all the women out here are just, like, doing queen shit all day every day, and the boys are out here trying their best. The boys in this story, Kale, Rowan, Dorian, I love them all. They all really try hard, but, like, they struggle, they have a hard time, and that's okay. What does this tell you about me? That I'm, like, I'm a basic girly at heart. I like grew up in the late aughties, and I love a good fantasy romance. Although, like, the romance is my least favorite aspect of the Throne of Glass series. Not that it's bad, I love all of it so much, but, like, really, the fact that all the stuff from, like, Assassin's Blade comes back at the end. Shut the front door. I also read it using the romantic method. It is the method I would recommend, which means you do Throne of Glass, then you do the second book, and then you do Assassin's Blade before you do Air of Fire, because I think that's the best way to do it. Assassin's Blade will still break your heart. You lose out on one, like, big, you're, like, spoiled on one, like, major event, but honestly, I found it just as impactful. Whew, Assassin's Blade got me crying good. I cried in all the books. I'm a big crier. I was, like, on YouTube this morning, and there was this girl, and she was looking at, she, like, listed all the books she cried in, reading in 2021, and I was like, that would be, like, 80 books. I cried in a lot of books. I'm an easy book crier. It was not that impressive. Anyway. That's all I have. Those are my top 10 books of 2021. It's like the date is like still very confusing to me. We're like a week into January. And I kind of still feel like it should be 2020. Anyway, I'm done. That's all. That's all I had for you.